So, in the interest of getting this to all of you who are not being able to make it tonight, Judy and I, we are going to go through tonight's lesson and workout and hopefully send it off to everybody else. Cool?
They'll appreciate that.
I hope so. All right, so let's open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. Lord, I thank you for this one-on-one time with Judy that the two of us get to move our bodies and worship you in a completely unique way. Lord, thank you for giving us this opportunity. Thank you for being here in this place, Lord. And we ask that you would just bless this time, Lord. Open our eyes to parts of your word that maybe we haven't really paid much attention to, but you want us to specifically hear tonight. And Lord, I just pray that this time is honoring and glorifying to you. And those who may watch it later, Lord, I pray for your blessings upon them as they work through not just the physical part of this, but the foundations of faith part as well. Lord, open their minds and their hearts to what it is that you have to show them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so today will be pretty much the same workout we did last week. So we're going to kind of do one workout for a few weeks till we get kind of acclimated and feel pretty good with it. The content of the teaching will be different every week. So that part will surely change. The actual fitness part of it will likely stay about the same. We'll kind of add and subtract as we go. Okay? So you will need your drumsticks, but not right now. We will get to that. All right? So we're going to warm up a little bit first. All right. March. There we go. Out, out, in. Good. Step, 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 step. Whatever you want to do with the arms is fine. Out, out, in. Good. It's a fun song. Clap it out. Little squat.
this crazy love, not sin.
Two more.
Not sound crazy, but one day a key will lock us up.
Speaking of good songs, we're walking forward four steps. One, two, three, four, back. We step out, 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 out. Good, forward. Four, three, two, one, back. Four, three, two, one, reach. There you go. Okay. Back up to your chair. One foot out in front of you. Back is nice and straight. Just down and up. At your own pace. Just want you to get a nice little stretch right about there. Come back up. Switch feet. Very good. Come back up to standing. And walk. One, two, three. Four, back. Step out. One, two, woo. Three. You got a little excited about that one. One, two, three, four, back. One, two, three, four. Step out. One, two, three, four. Very good. Go ahead and step back to your chair. I don't know where my chair is. And have a seat. Legs spread wide. We're going to reach up and over. Down. We tend to ignore our side body a lot. There's a lot of stuff that happens in that side body. And stand up. Get ready to walk. And forward, go. One, two, three, four, back. Step out. One, two, three, four. Go forward. Back. Step out. Out, out, out. Forward, back one more time. Step out. But just to review for some who may not have seen it or been here, three straight moves is what we're going to do, okay, for about 45 seconds, 10-second break, and then we'll go through the next move, so on and so forth, okay? Our first move of this block is that hip hinge. If you're standing in front of a chair, when you hinge, you should feel your calves hit that chair. Keep your chest up and shoulder blades back. That's your hip hinge. Our second move is a sit to stand. Nose out over the toes. Good, not too far out over the toes though. So that's move two. Move three, we're going to tilt side to side. All right? Perfect. Okay. I'm just going to use that. I'll just go for that. Okay. Here we go. Ready to hinge right here. And down we go. Good. Remember, what matters more than how many you do is your form as you're doing it. So last week, just to recap what we talked about. We talked about Genesis 1:1, which says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Keep going. You're doing great. We've got less than 10 seconds left, and we got a little bit of a break. Very good. Three, two, one, and rest. Shake those legs out if you need to. Just a little break before we those sit to stands. So we talked last week. Go ahead and sit and stand. If you need to use the arms, nothing wrong with that. We want to just make sure that you're really cueing into those legs to make them work too. So in talking about Genesis 1:1 last week, we talked also about how when God created everything, he spoke it into existence with the exception of one thing, and that was man. Man, he formed from the dust of the earth, and he breathed life into the nostrils of man, and man became a living, breathing being in that moment. And rest. Good. Woo! Jello legs. All right, go ahead and have a seat. And we'll head into those side bends. So you're just going to slide your hand down. There you go. Perfect. So from that point, we don't really know for how much time, but for a limited amount of time, God dwelled with, walked with, talked with his creation directly. He walked and talked with Adam and Eve. We did not talk about how God made me. We need to talk about that. We will talk about that. But God walked and talked with them and rest. And that's not an over-exaggeration. It was. Everything was the way it was supposed to be. There was no death. There was no pain. There was no hurt. There was no illness. None of that existed on the earth, in animals or in people or in the earth itself. Today, we learn about the fall of that, literally the fall of that. Go ahead and stand up. We're going to do our last set of those hinges. Here we go. Good. So we do also know that part of God's creation was a creation of angels. And specifically, there was an angel referred to as the morning star. And he was a beautiful angel. The Bible talks about him as such, until his heart was wicked. This angel, as we refer to him, is also known as Lucifer. You don't hear him spoken of as morning star anymore. And stop and rest. We know him as Lucifer, and throughout the rest of the Bible, he's referred to as Satan, or the father of lies, prince of lies, prince of darkness. Not so nice names, but he was an angel, and his downfall was that he decided that he wanted to be like God. Not only did he want to be like God, he really wanted to take God's place or take his position. So his goal was to get to receive worship. That's what he wanted. He wanted the worship and that adoration that is due only to God. As you know, that's not really taken too lightly. And we hear what God did to him as a result of that. He cast him down. There you go. Very good. But along with him, Satan did not go by himself. There was a group of angels that chose to follow him. They are now referred to as demons. They started out as angels. So, flash forward then a little bit to the garden. God had told Adam and Eve, one more. God told Adam and Eve that you may eat of the fruit of any of the trees of the garden, with the exception of this tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, today, we talk about what happens at that tree and what it means for all mankind and for all of creation from that point. So as we finish up with this little part of our workout, to think about life before the fall. Life before the decision made by the first two people to ever walk the earth. Life before that decision changed everything. All right. Okay. To shake your legs out if you want to. If you want to get up and walk around, go right ahead. We're going to take a little bit of a break here. We're actually going to read through Genesis 3, 1 through 4. Genesis 3, 1 through 4 says, "Now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Indeed, has God said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden?' The woman said to the serpent, 'From the tree, or from the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat. But from the fruit of the tree, which is in the middle of the garden, God said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die.' The serpent said to the woman, 'You surely will not die.'" Verse 5 then goes on to discuss the rest of what the serpent said to Eve. And that is, "For God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So one of the reasons I want to really stick on that passage a little bit today is because I think it's important to note that when the serpent came to Eve, he didn't come in, you know, the red, like, devil suit with the tail and the pitchfork and things like that. He came as one of the animals that was already on the earth with them. And he didn't come with a horrible threat to her. You know, he didn't say, "Eat of this fruit or else." All he did was ask a question. That's it. A simple question. Did he really say? And that question was enough to plant a tiny bit of doubt in her mind. And her answer to it plants a little bit more of a doubt in her own mind. His answer to her then really blows that doubt up in her head. His goal in talking to Eve was he knows he can't ruin her, but he knows that he can draw her away from God and he can separate them. So his goal even now isn't to win the battle, because he knows he's not going to win the battle. He knows his time is limited. He knows that. But his goal is to draw God's people away from him and to put a barrier there. His goal is to cause doubt. That's it. Not a big world catastrophe. Just doubt. Just enough to question. So that's where we're going to leave that for right now. Okay. We're going to use our hip hinges a little bit here. So I want you to go behind your chair first. What we're going to do is we're going to reach back and then come up. Reach back. Good. Just keep going just like that. Your back stays nice and straight. We're reaching back. Almost like we're trying to kind of dip our toe in a pool of water to see how cold it is. Very good. So we pulled before, now we're pushing. Good, keep your elbows glued to your sides.
Much attention to it and rest.
Because anywhere else in Genesis before. And all of a sudden, after her conversation with the serpent, she looks at the fruit and sees that it is good for eating, that it's appealing, that it's appetizing. And she takes it, she eats it, she gives it to her husband, who, by the way, had the direct direction from God to not eat of that, right? All right, let's go into that plane. And home. And in that moment, one bite changed everything. I don't know about you, but I have heard all of my life that, ooh, that donut or that pizza, you know, 10 minutes or 10 seconds on the lips and a lifetime on the hips, right? Now, honestly, that doesn't sound so bad. And relax. In comparison, for Adam and Eve, 10 seconds on the lips and an eternity of sin enters the world in one bite, 1 second, one choice. All right, here we go. Last set of these, starting up like a goalpost. Together, apart, push, and pull.
This ain't the kind of place that you want to know.
So before this point, the world is perfect. There's no death, there's no pain, there's no illness. Everything is pure, everything is perfect. One conversation leads to one doubt, leads to one bite, leads to an eternity of sin, of pain, of death, of illness, of murder, of stealing, of lying, and rest, and disrest. Technically, that came at a bad time. All right, we're gonna go to our rows in about 5 seconds here. Go into that lunge position, and start pulling back to your hip. Very good. Has come into the rest of us automatically. I hate to break it to you, but you are born already a sinner. It's not because of a choice that you make when you're a year old. It's not because of a choice that you make when you're 10. You are born with a sin nature. This means on your own, you cannot in any way achieve the righteousness that it would take for you to stand before and with God in a holy place. Almost there. A couple more seconds. I'm going to go a little bit longer on this one. You got this. And rest. Very good. But in order to give you good, accurate depiction of the gospel in a whole, I have to bring you the bad news. Because if you don't understand the bad news, the good news doesn't mean anything. So we have to talk about this. We are all yucky in here. Everything, not just a little piece of our heart, every bit of your heart is yucky. It's bad, it's evil, it's sinful. You were born that way. And I'm not coming down on anyone in particular. It just is what it is. But
when we finish up tonight, I'm going to give you the hope that comes after that. And then the rest of these weeks, we're going to spend talking about that hope. Have a seat. Arms out. Pull back. Open. Close. Pull. Close. Open. Good. Nice and slow. Speed it up. One, two, three, four. One, two, three. Good. Keep going. We're going to switch here. Start down, down.
Speed it up. One, two, one, two.
up. One, two, three, four, up. Two hips down. One, two, up. One, two, up. Drumsticks down. We don't need those guys anymore. So I'm going to skip ahead. We're going to go ahead a couple thousand years. And we're going into the book of Romans, specifically Romans 5, 17, and 18, which says, "For if by the transgression of the one, death reigned through the one, much more those who receive the abundance of grace and of the grace of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. So then, as through one transgression, there resulted condemnation for all men, even so, through one act of righteousness, there resulted justification of life to all men." Through one man entered sin. We're going to put our arms out. I want you to reach. Good. So we're kind of stretching through those tummy muscles. Good. Sin entered the world through one man. But it was also through one man that all of the transgressions or sins of all men ever will be washed away. And that is the rest of what we talk about the rest of our time here these next few weeks. And not that I want to beat a dead horse here, I don't, but it's important to me that you understand that you in and of yourself do not have the capability and the ability at all, no matter how hard you try, to meet the qualifications of righteousness that are required to get you into heaven. It's just not possible. It's not that it's difficult, it's that it is impossible. So, I want you to see something here, and we'll talk a little bit more about this next week, but I want to give a little bit of a preview for it. Go ahead and reach one arm up and over. Try to touch the back of your shoulder if you can. Just push back a little bit. You should give a stretch right in there. I want to shine a little light on a piece of this story. So, after Adam and Eve ate, sin entered the world through one bite. And God came looking for them, as he always did, because he walked and talked with them on a regular basis. And we're going to skip over a few things. We're just going to summarize this a little bit. He went looking for them. He asked them where they were. He didn't really need to ask because he knew, because he's God. But he gave them an opportunity. Go ahead and pull your shoulder blades. Draw your chin. He gave them an opportunity to repent of what they had done wrong. So right away, from the beginning, God's giving his people a chance to come to him, to turn to him, and turn away from their ways, except they choose not to. And God does what he has to do at that point. We're going to reach up and over. Because of what they had done, they can no longer live in his perfect garden anymore. And he casts them out. But he doesn't just cast them out and send them on their way and good riddance, you're done. No. He sacrifices. He makes the first sacrifice ever. And he does it for the two sinful people that he placed on the earth. And he does it, go ahead and have a seat. He does it to cover them, to cover their shame, to cover their guilt, to clothe their bodies that they now realize are naked. He provides for them, even though they chose to not just walk away from him, but then once confronted by him, chose to continue
to walk in that direction, and he still provides for them. And that's going to be what we talk about next week. So just to give you a little bit of a preview, we're talking about provision. I've been spending the last couple weeks going through the minor prophets of the Old Testament. So have you go ahead and put one leg kind of out to the side. And we're going to lean forward. And the minor prophets are something that I've kind of not paid much attention to before. because to be honest, they're not the fun parts of the Bible to read. There's a lot of hurt and a lot of sadness and a lot of depravity in the minor prophets. But what I failed to see before until now was that there's a whole lot of love and patience in those minor prophet books. continue to pour out your grace on us every single day. Even though every single day, the choices that we make, whether they're little or they're big, they align us with Adam's sin. That is our nature. But Lord, we thank you that as you look at us the way we are now, once we have received your Son into our hearts, Lord, you look at us and you see him. You see his righteousness, not our sin. And we don't deserve that. Lord, but you give it freely and with open arms. So Lord, while this is a hard message to hear, it's unpleasant to hear that we're not as special as the world tends to tell us all that we are, that we're all so special and that we all deserve happiness and every possible gift imaginable. Lord, thank you for the reminder that it is not because we're special that we're yours, that it's your sovereignty that actually has saved us from what we truly deserve. Lord, I thank you for this evening. I thank you for this time with Judy and with anyone else who happens to see this later. Lord, I pray that it was a blessing to them. And Lord, thank you for allowing me to be the one to bring that message today. And I pray, Lord, that as it was brought in a way that is clear and honoring and glorifying to you, even though it is also very apparent that I am a human bringing that message. Lord, we love you so much. Go with us, go before us, keep us safe. Help us to be a blessing to everyone we come across as we go through the rest of our week.
Spin me around and love that song.